back to anesthetic drugs. So again, our drugs are so specialized. And so the way I think of this is, you know, if I want to buy a laptop, there's just a gazillion details, right? So what I try to do is find the point of difference between each product. It's kind of like using the critical issue in the other scenarios that we talked about, but then tailoring it to what makes this agent different or better or worse than another. And so this is what I had to learn for my part one exam, which just sounds incredibly annoying. But really what you notice is there's a whole bunch of patterns in this very, very busy, complex table. So I won't even bore you with that. So a lot of minutiae. The pharmaceutics, kinetics, and dynamics for each drug are important, but this is mostly useful to pass some really bad part one exam stuff. But in real life, all of our decisions are made on just a few crucial facts. And in the tables I've provided, I find that these are really my decision-making facts of each drug. And you'll get very comfortable with a few patterns as we go on. So here are a few aspects of hypnotic agents. I'm just thinking I'm not going to go through them in too much detail, because we'll go through the cases, and I think that's a far better way of learning this than me just telling you stuff that's on a slide. Rocuronium, atrocumin, suxamethonium, they have certain peculiarities. Again, and there's no ideal agent. Like in some situations, you may just have bad effects of any drug on that patient, and you just have to decide, and that's quite common as well. And here your analgesics. So I'm just going through these three facets, because the induction agents, hypnotics, analgesics, and relaxants are the three agents that are very anesthetically relevant, and the ones you'll have to decide on as you're presenting, you know, your case to your boss and drawing out your medication. So again, the most practically relevant ones are these small tables. Let's give you a bit of practice with this. So page 22, or near to page 22, choose your induction meds. So I want you to choose your hypnotic, analgesic, and muscle paralytic agent for these cases. You've got a 50-year-old female for a laparoscopic cholecystectomy with renal impairment. So I just want you to make a call, a judgment about what you'd choose.
I guess I think in terms of medications, even though she's got renal impairment, propofol, fentanyl, rocuronium.
Yeah, absolutely. And why did you choose rocuronium in spite of the renal impairment?
I guess because I think that succinylcholine would probably be the other relaxant I'd be thinking, but you know, the side effects, mm-hmm. you know, are probably worse for someone with renal impairment, like the high K, and it's got similar sort of like high anaphylaxis rate as well. So
great. Now, rocuronium and succinylcholine both have a high anaphylaxis rate. Are there any medications, relaxants you could give that have no renal issue at all? And you'll see this pattern time and time again. Your answer is not wrong, by the way. So mm-hmm. propofol with SIVA maintenance, completely the regular thing that most people would do. Fentanyl, correct, because morphine has active metabolites that may accumulate. That said, there's plenty of times you'd use morphine as well, depending on how bad the renal failure is. Just see that there's so many gray areas here. Again, I just want you to come up with a reasonable decision and know how you got to that decision, because that's what matters, that you're making these decisions, acting like a senior person. Atrocumin and cisatrocumin are both non-organ dependent, so they will just be eliminated regardless of whatever renal or liver impairment there is. But there's plenty of people that would use rocuronium because it's also renal and liver excreted. So I'm giving you a whole lot of ifs and buts, but just to show you that there's sometimes multiple things you can use, but just to be able to, you know, there's no real right or wrong answer. If you said exactly right, if you need succinylcholine, it has a high anaphylaxis rate. And I'd also check the potassium in a patient with renal failure, because succinylcholine can cause a rapid rise in potassium. If they're already hyperkalemic, that can be lethal. Let's go to this one. 60-year-old female for umbilical hernia repair. They've got a strong history of postoperative nausea and vomiting, and they look like a difficult bag mass ventilation. But let's say the intubation looks pretty easy to do.
This patient, mm-hmm. With a difficult bag mask, you don't really want to have a prolonged duration to wait with the muscle relaxant. So something like succinylcholine, if it's not contraindicated, or a high dose ROC mm-hmm. could be chosen. And then with the postoperative nausea, vomiting, you could choose a TEVA technique mm-hmm. Or just add a few extra antiemetics.
Fantastic. That's exactly right. So if it was that bad, I'd use TEVA, so propofol induction and maintenance. So instead of running the gas, I'd run propofol through the drip. Fentanyl, but you could really use any any combination there, multimodal plus opioids. And then you're exactly right. Fast relaxant means you don't have to spend time trying to bag mask someone who's difficult to bag mask. So sux or high dose rocuronium. And if you haven't done anesthetics, you'll see this pattern often enough. 70-year-old male, the next case, laparoscopic nephrectomy, cardiac, renal, and liver impairment, and asthma. So quite a few things.
Yeah, wonderful. So I would probably do a propofol induction with fentanyl despite the renal impairment, mm-hmm. only using a sort of small amount and then considering mm-hmm. some of the non-organ dependent opiates infusion throughout mm-hmm. the case if needed. Mm-hmm. And then a sysetric for the paralysis given that it's Hoffman elimination.
That's great. So propofol, ketamine, midaz induction. Let's say I've done that because they're a cardiac patient and I'll go through that in the induction section. Remifantanil and fentanyl. So, you know, if it's a long case and liver and renal impairment, maybe I want to run remi. So at the end of the case, there's no remi left because it's such a fast offset. And then I can give fentanyl, which has less active metabolites. And there's no real perfect option for relaxant. You know, sisatricream has no histamine release and non-organ dependent. There's really slow onset. And it can be quite frustrating bagging the patient for 5 minutes before intubation. Rocuronium can be reversed, so that's often good, but it is organ dependent. And atricurium has histamine release, but again, it's not the biggest thing. You can use atricurium in asthmatic patients, and it's, you know, can be fine, but just have a reason for why you'd use one or the other. Final case, 30-year-old female for GA cesarean section with preeclampsia. What are your induction meds?
Lahiru. I just thought I'd check. So why are we avoiding histamine release for a patient? Is that to avoid hypotension, like vasodilation? Or
And you could make an argument for that. Histamine with bronchoconstriction. It's just a thing that people talk about. Again, I don't know is this a real high yield thing or not? Probably not, but it's something that people talk about. And it's good to know that it causes histamine release and you might want to avoid it if you could. For bronchospasm for the asthma.
So I don't know much about pregnant people.
That's right.
But I sort of the considerations would be possibly things that aren't going to cross the placenta or impact the baby.
Yep.
And also, I guess the question is if it's an emergency procedure, probably induced with something fast acting.
Exactly. And what do you reckon? Induction agent, what do you reckon?
Maybe rocuronium.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah.
So propofol is almost very safe in pregnancy. It would be the most common drug we'd induce with these days. And you're very right about worrying about placental transmission of agents. So we'd use alfentanil to avoid placental transfer of a slightly longer acting opioid like fentanyl. Alfentanil is very quick as well and shorter acting. So you get this fast onset to prevent any blood pressure spike with intubation. Which is really great in preeclampsia because, you know, that hypertension can cause intracranial hemorrhages. And it's emergency and in an aspiration risk patient, which almost every patient is who's pregnant by definition. So fast relaxant, either sux or rocuronium. So you're absolutely right about that as well. That's really good. My aim for this is to be able to just give you an insight into some of the decision-making points. Sometimes there's really poor evidence for one or the other. And it's not the most important thing, but it's very important that you would, you know, talk about it in this kind of way to show that you know the information. There's one of the situations, and you want to be seen to know stuff, even though some of the actual decisions don't have any good evidence or would even matter that much. And so take this for what it is. It's just a common talk and chat around the anesthesia inductions that we're talking about here. This is in your workbook, so common drugs and doses. I won't go into this. Drawing up tricky meds. It's one of those things that no one ever went through with me. so that's on the YouTube channel as well for the difficult meds like drawing up, I think, tazosin and kefazolin and propofol quickly. And again, just practice enough and you'll get good at it. Good question. Can we omit the opioids until the baby is out or is it expected in the preeclampsia? That some opioid is given. Yeah, it's almost because you've got to do it so rapidly and we always worry about a risk of awareness, almost always you'd give alfentanil. But I agree that if you gave enough propofol to this patient, chances are they'd feel the pain and become very tachycardic. So if they didn't have preeclampsia, you could just give it without alfentanil. the fact is, if you had a severe tachycardia and had a blood pressure spike, the intracranial hemorrhage risk is this unknown factor. That's why I would give alfentanil for this preeclampsia patient. But that's a really good question. Most people would give alfentanil in this.